Okay, so where I left off was I was just penciling Kaitana into position here, as these two young ladies have a bit of a conflict. And there we go. I like those eyes a bit better. Now, one thing that's kind of neat is it's been fun figuring out clothing for these girls, right? Up here, I've got Michelle's wearing her sort of outdoors wear. She's got, you know, shorts and t-shirt and some little hiking boots there. She's not afraid of bug spray or whatever. Whereas Kaitana can't quite see her, but she's sort of wearing a skirt and a vest and some very fashionable clothes. She very quickly worked out what you're supposed to wear, how fashion worked on Earth, and who the winners / losers are in that particular silly game, and got right into it. And like these are just sort of things that she just naturally gets, you know. And I think that's fascinating. And Michelle, of course, just doesn't care so much. I mean, fashion's a wonderful thing. I remember when I was younger, I'd worry about these things, and my you know first decision with regard to it all was, you know, I didn't want people judging me based on how I dressed. I didn't want to play the fashion game. I wanted people to like me for me. You know, that's the lesson they tell you to follow, and which, you know, obviously isn't true. The way you dress is how people judge you. It's their first impression. But I didn't want to, you know, be fake. I didn't want to dress in a way that led people to think that I was something other than what I was. You know, it's this big struggle, and I know a number of people have gone through this. It's a strange moral struggle, whereas others are, you know, more than happy, Kaitana included, to sort of jump in and establish a social dominance through fashion. You know, there's a great deal of power in it, and if used in certain ways, then you can win at society. And then I figured out how to do it, right? Where you instead of thinking of it as a game or as a lie or as a way of determining truth about someone. Whoops, wrong here on Tom there. I realized that fashion is a lot of fun. This is how Michelle would think of it. Is you know you can affect the way people respond to you in the world in a positive way with the stuff you wear. I realized that, you know, you're walking around every day wearing a canvas. You know, like I like the way I want my paintings and my drawings to look nice, and you know I'm affecting people in that kind of a. In the same sort of ways, I'm touching on the same parts of their minds by producing graphic effects. So why wouldn't I want to do that with my body and with the things that I wear? And when I realized that was one way of thinking about it that I found acceptable, it became a lot easier. You know, I didn't figure that out until much, much later in the game of life. And so Michelle thinks of, hey, you know, her body is a canvas, and you can wear clothes that are fun, and she likes things that reflect how she feels inside, and it becomes this very positive thing as opposed to something that you can allow to hurt you and to control who you are. And there's so much that comes from someone's intent, but so you can sort of see again. So here, and you know, and plus Kaitana, she's the thing that's interesting about this town that I live in. Is I'm just gonna set up the scene here. If I'm talking too much, I'll forget what I'm trying to do. So here we have Drew. He chimes back in. He's saying, "Hey, well, you know, tell that to the goats." Actually, I'm gonna do this in a different way. Let's do more layout theory here. Pardon me, I'm just gonna get a drink of water here. That's better. Okay, so we got the campfire here. We can move the camera around. Some flames here. This is where Drew's sitting. and a shell's over here, and Jen will just sort of be between them looking at the two. And Drew, again, he's just sort of like, he's joking. There's his long head and sort of squarish chin. And these sorts of bits of hair hanging out here. He's not quite taking any of this seriously, you know. That's his defense for the extreme weirdness that having aliens in your neighborhood, real outer space aliens, has. So he just laughs it off, or he just sort of pretends that I'm not sure if he seems smart enough to not get stuck. Like, he's a guy who understands probably what cognitive dissonance is, where you're trying to believe two incompatible things at the same time and function within that, you know, within those limits. But but it's entirely possible to do that, because, you know, when one part of your mind is in the house, believing it's at the flagship of your mind, believing one thing, it's entirely possible to forget that you have another viewpoint that you could also believe. So even really smart people like Drew can fall prey to that. His arm's not supposed to be back there. And I've seen this before, where, you know, people, really smart people, when faced with the impossible, just sort of shut down or blink or just hope that the problem goes away so they can just carry on. It's difficult to, you know, to put your mind in order so that you can deal with this stuff. And so Drew's way is to simply laugh it off. Don't think about it too much, because thinking about it requires certain realities that he's not quite willing to accept. And so he's just going to say, ah, you know, maybe Ashelle's just nuts. Maybe she's just got her friends convinced. You know, and someone like Tom would go, well, how do you explain? You know, Tom's a thinker. He's not willing to settle for comfortable realities. He's got his discomforts. He's brave because he faces those things. Or, you know, he's willing to face them. It doesn't make them necessarily easy. Like when Jenny Mysterious showed up and made him face himself, he turned kind of sickly green and just was like, oh my god, how am I going to deal with the fact that Shell is an actual alien? But he went through it. He dealt with it. He thought about it. He opened himself up to that. So in this particular situation, where Drew's just going, oh yeah, you know, Shell's just crazy. He's got her friends convinced. You know, she's an interesting girl. All the little weird inconsistencies with that belief system. He's, you know, Tom would look at it, well, how do you explain Kaitana? How do you explain this girl? She's another person claiming to be a space princess. Is she lying? Is it a sort of tag team con? Is this some kind of long con? Are they going to ask for money at some point? Is that what you're expecting? You know, how do you? A lot of other weird little inconsistencies. How do you explain those? Oh well, you know, I don't. And I'm sure a guy like Drew could come up with it, or just shift subject. You know, he just not think about it. He's practiced the art of not thinking when it's too difficult, and it's unfortunate because. Who knows? Maybe he'll come around, but right now he's the way he's dealing with it. He's got to make it funny. So he's had a little. All right. So there's Drew, and then I'm gonna make Jen's head a little bigger here. Where is she exactly? She's right here in this little box thing with a guitar. So I'll just have her here looking at him. And she wants to talk about. I have a whole strip where she wants to talk about her time travel thing. Like, you know, the way, whoops, she's not talking. And she's not that unhappy. She's just sort of. Let's go and type for this. This is one of those shots where it's gotta be just so. I'll have her ear poking out. No. One of these sort of, like, the mouth has to sort of say, there it is. That's exactly what I'm after. You can express so much just with a little wavy line for the mouth. that mouth is saying. She's not angry, she's not upset, but she's definitely taking in the fact that he's that Drew is not taking this seriously, that he thinks maybe he's going to laugh at the situation. And, you know, Jen, she's got enough weird stuff going on in her life now. Like, she was visited by Jenny Mysterious. She's living two alternate timelines at the same time. She's, got some really weird stuff happening in her life, and she needs to talk about this. And later on in the story, she's, like, or the next strip, she'll be leading them all in a sing-along, where she'll be playing the guitar while the guys entertain the girls with, with camp songs. Okay, so she'll just be there. I'll draw the guitar in a second. I have to have a shell reacting here. She's leaning forward. We'll have the fire over here. There's a couple flames. So, didn't show you that because we're in really tight here. Anyway, so at one point, after, you know, Jen plays the guitar, and Tom is like, when did you learn how to play? You know, like, how did that work? And, and Jen's like, well, you know, like, well, how come you never told me? He says, well, actually, it's a little weirder than that. There's a long story behind it. He goes, oh, what is that long story? I don't think that hits quite the right size. I think we flubbed that. I want to make that eye looking at least over here. And we can bring the ear in. There we go. Got to, again, make that line of sight work. Anyway, she'll be like, you know, well, I'd like to tell you, but, you know, I want to do it when there's less people around. I don't want to talk about it with that Drew guy here. She's not going to say that because she, you know, quite likes him. And she's got a place to live because Drew, set her up in this in the current apartment she's in. So he's a good guy. He's liking to help. But she doesn't want to tell him that she's a time-traveling rock star. So this is what this expression is. She's just learning. This is what happened. She upsets my alien friend here. So let's put a hand in here. Hands are wonderfully expressive. Even if you draw them too big. Oh no, that's not bad. Perfect. I like it. There we go. Clean that up in the ink. Okay. Now we'll finish this off here. How is her collar looking? Just a regular t-shirt. I think I'm gonna give her like a rock star. Slightly different t-shirt there. And one thing I wanted to do is I noticed when I was looking at you know, how guitarists hold guitars. One thing I did for Jen was when a new guitarist is just learning how, and they've just taken a few lessons and they're playing for their friends, they hold the guitar really close to themselves in a very sort of almost an awkward way, whereas people who've been playing for 20 years, it's almost a piece of furniture. They sort of lean on it, and they're very, very comfortable in how they handle the guitar. So I wanted to give that to Jen. I figured that was something she's inherited. The guitar is like, it's her own hand at this point. She's super comfortable with it. So I gave her a nice relaxed pose and just put it across her knees like that. I'm going to do the same here. Except I don't really know how to draw guitars. I have to do lots of photo reference work. But I think I got this here. I'm going to stick it up this way. Go. Doesn't have to be that. And again, these panels don't have to be as crazy detailed as all this, because they're going to print very small. This will be maybe 2 inches across when it goes to press. So let's just put some trees in the background here and call this another panel. I don't think I'm going to take you through the whole strip here. I've got another, let's see, I'm halfway through penciling it. Maybe I'll think of a really cool background shot. Actually, one thing here that I notice, and this happens a lot with these tablets, is, you know, his head's too small. The rest of his body is demanding a larger head, and I notice this stuff often right when I'm just about to send it to press. I'm like, oh, wait a sec, what's up with that awful hand, or Shell's head is like two sizes too big. The thing that's nice about this this computer tablet is you can really easily fix stuff like that. I'll do that right now. So let's pull back and go Control T. It brings up this thing where you can rotate and change the size. It's a bit too big. It's just a touch. There we go. And there it is. That's better. That fits. Now these are in the same scale range as Jen and the other one. So there we are. I just got to finish this up here. And then I can call this a piece of penciling. Move on to the next panel. This strip's a day late. The grapevine where this the little newspaper in town where Stardrop runs, they didn't press. They missed an issue because the people who run the printing plant are on holiday. So they figured, well, and they get a bit of a deal with the printing plant. So because they print in town, and the editor was like, well, you know. It's not worth the, it'll cost more if I take it to another printing plant just for this one issue. It's a lot of complication, and, you know, I'll make $10 as opposed to, you know, enough to make it worth my time. So he figured, you know what, we'll just skip an issue. And I was saying, hey, you know, I'm a believer in astrology, and I was saying, hey, we're in the middle of a big Mercury retrograde right now, and that's all about communications crapping out, and, you know, you might want to. I've seen this sort of thing happen. It doesn't surprise me at all. The printing plant would, you know, go kaput in the month that when you need it. It's just standard. So many things have been going wrong this month, but some things work out nicely, like older stuff or things that require sort of deeper thinking and older projects that bubble to the surface. Like I've gotten a lot of good stuff done on some Thieves and Kings scripts, actually. That's sort of been defunct for a while, and there's some cool announcements I'm going to make in regard to that fairly soon. And that stuff's been bubbling up quite nicely, but yeah, I was, you know, I've seen projects like, you know, during a retrograde, you'll be like, okay, my printer blew up, you know, well, okay, I'll fix my printer. This has to go to press, so we'll solve that problem. And then your printer's working. Oh no! And then your scanner breaks down. You're like, oh my god, my scanner broke. How can that be? And then you fix that, and then something else goes wrong, or the thing that you replace it with. Got to go back to the shop because the wrong cartridge came with it. See, oh, the shop's closed. Oh, your bicycle tire blew, or your car runs into something. And the thing is, every time you fight your way through a solution, something else will sort of break. And honestly, I've gotten to the point where I'm going, I think things are getting worse and worse and worse. The stress level is rising and rising, and the universe just doesn't want you to get this thing done, you know? It's just trying to stop you, just trying to slow you down. Everything's feeling dreamy and odd. And if you just push through it, my God, I think if you push it far enough, I was telling Jeremy, like, this is how it goes. You know, if you push it too much and you don't let up, I think you can actually die. I think you can give yourself a heart attack or, you know, get. And there's been some car accidents and some pretty harsh stuff that have been going on this month. So just, you know, chill out, pull back. And that's hard to do in our day and age when things aren't set schedules. But, If you can afford it, just when something's really slowing down and just wants to not go ahead, give it some time. You'll have plenty of time to power ahead and in the future. Anyway, we're at 20 minutes. I'm going to call this a video, and I don't think I'm going to make another one unless I've got a really cool picture idea. I'll stop this at 2. And you can come to my website and see the finished version of this in a few hours' time when I get it posted. And that's a video. All right, hope you've enjoyed watching, and have a great day, and take care.